Should we talk about the conventions, not about the Hoekstra campaign?
No, I understand.
I'm not going to sit here and dig into the intricacies of the Hoekstra campaign 8 weeks before primary.
Benjamin seems so kind of abrasive when you see him out doing things. How did he get to
abrasive? He got 70% of the vote. That's not too bad.
Yeah. No, I mean among the party. How did you get that?
How did you get to 70%?
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of Tea Party energy out there. I give the Tea Party all the credit in that race. Solanusis has been around for a while. There does tend to be this, you know, about every 10 years there's a change in leadership in the party. My family certainly went through that, and I think that in some degree it's happening again, but the Tea Party energy is very, very strong out there, and they're very well organized. We helped provide them some tools and some knowledge of convention systems, but they have the passion and the energy.
Who's going to be the new communications person for Pete? Because you guys aren't sticking with Paul Shermataro's firm now, right?
Yeah, we'll have an announcement on that in the next couple of days. I do believe BlackRock is still going to be involved in some way, but we've always had plans to bring on a full-time communications director. That announcement should be made today or tomorrow.
In what way will Fred Davis still be involved?
I'm not going to get into the intricacies of the Hoekstra campaign.
You just answered Kathy's question.
We'll have an announcement in due time.
Romney, where is he weak? Where is he strong?
Romney, you know, the country is looking for somebody to put the economy back on the right track. And so to that extent, he's a very credible messenger as someone who can fix the economy. I do think that he needs to probably lay out a vision at some point in time. I'm sure they have plans to do that, but I think his strength is currently the
lay out a vision.
Yeah, a vision for the future of the country.
Sage the bush. Well, the vision is I'm turning the economy around.
Okay.
He needs more than a 59-point plan.
You worked on a lot of different presidential campaigns. Why didn't you want to work with Romney?
I never said I didn't want to work with Romney.
They never wanted you.
I don't sit up at night waiting for the phone call from the Romney campaign to come to work for them.
That's not going
to
happen.
But, you know, I choose candidates based on those that I'm attracted to. And I was, in the beginning of this process, I was very attracted to Herman Cain. He was an anti-establishment candidate. He fit very well with how I see the future of the country and the campaigns that style of campaigns that I've done in the past. So I chose to go that direction. Eventually, he obviously got out of the race. And at that point, you know, I was only going to go with a candidate who was going to contest Michigan.
Does Romney connect with voters?
Well, he just won several presidential primaries.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying. You know what I'm asking.
You know, I think his strength is as a CEO type, an executive type, and somebody who can fix the economy. Does he connect with voters on a one-on-one basis as well as some of the other candidates in the race? Probably not, but I don't think in the age of television ads and major speeches, I don't think that's necessarily determinative.
Is the Yob versus Inuzis feud over? Did you win? or is there another battle that we get to look forward to?
I hope it's over. I thought it was over before. You know, Saul and I had some tough times from 2005 to 2008. Then we actually became, I would say, friends and possibly even allies in some ways. I helped him in his RNC chair campaign. You know, in this business, campaigns can bring about disagreements. I strongly disagreed with how the delegate scandal was handled and implemented. I thought it was unnecessary, and therefore I couldn't support Saul for re-election. I didn't intend to be particularly involved in the campaign or try to recruit anyone or anything like that. I was on vacation on April 1st and woke up to a Palm Sunday, what I thought was an April Fool's email from Saul being overly critical, if you will, of me and our business. And so at that point I decided to get a little more involved in the campaign.
I don't remember the delegate thing. What was that?
The Santorum?
No, that's the Santorum thing. Delegate. Oh, yeah.
That's very important, Tim. Right. That is what drove everything that's happened in the party in the last 2 months.
I mean, in hindsight,
really? That
absolutely.
That was the fire that ignited everybody?
Absolutely.
But no kidding.
In hindsight, it doesn't mean anything. I mean, because Santorum's not on the ballot, Romney's your nominee. So, you and why split the party?
But it was the principle.
It matters a lot that there's a party that's willing to change the rules after the rules are set after the election. That matters a lot.
Does it work for the Democrats to fight all the time? I mean, isn't that one of their huge weaknesses, that they have so many different interest groups that fight each other all the time?
You guys are supposed to be
one big happy family.
I've never attended a Democrat convention. I'm not very familiar with their internal dynamics.
It's a mess.
I've read that.
Have you talked to Bobby since the convention?
No.
He doesn't call.
Doesn't write. No Christmas card.
I don't get love letters.
No. There's a quote of the day. I don't get love letters.
How much does he have to raise to be safe?
To be safe. How much does he have to raise?
Challenge?
I don't believe that there's a number, but he has to raise a significant amount of money to in order to help Republicans win. You know, as you said, the House is important. The obviously, there's you have to fund victory programs across the state in a presidential election year, which is very, very expensive. There's a U.S. Senate race, so you know he's going to have to raise a substantial amount of money.
If Obama gets to 54-55% in Michigan, what is the fallout from that, if any?
I don't think that he'll get to 54-55% in Michigan, but obviously in many years the top of the ticket does drive other races. There's been a number of exceptions over the years. In 2002, Jennifer Granholm won by a number of points, and Terry Land still had the largest open seat victory in a generation. Mike Cox was the first Republican Attorney General in a generation elected that year. So there are exceptions to the rule that you're describing.
Mm-hmm. But if it got that high, you would be concerned.
Certainly, at the top of the ticket for either the Republicans or the Democrats overperforms, and that party is likely to do better down ballot.
Okay. Who are some of the other candidates you're working for nationally? You're involved in the Sherrod Brown race? Is that
yeah, I'm involved in five U.S. Senate races around the country. Yeah. It's Michigan, Ohio, Wisconsin, Florida, and North Dakota.
Who are your candidates?
I'm not going to disclose the internal details of my business.
What's your read on the recall over in Wisconsin? Have you been looking at it at that?
Yeah, I think Scott Walker is likely to win by somewhere between 6 and 10 points.
What turned that around?
You know, that's a good question. I didn't follow the race close yeah. enough to know that, but I think it's largely the economy. You know, the economy is turning around, so if the economy was bad and he had taken those actions and it wasn't working, then he would probably lose that. But because the economy has turned around, voters view what he's doing favorably, and therefore he'll probably more than survive it and probably become a national star because of it.
How much money does Santorum still owe you? I mean, I just saw the episode.
You're very
report.
Interested in my internal business.
Well, yeah, and
thanks.
So, evidently it's proprietary information who you're working for, so we can go see the FEC reports for that. But
sure.
I mean, there are FEC reports on Santorum. Mm-hmm. Last time around, he still owed you some money.
Does the Walker thing have, is that a, that's what I'm looking for. What does that do towards November? Is that an early indicator of the presidential race, what happens to Scott Walker?
I think it's a great sign for the party nationally. That the Democrats would try to take someone out. They did win some recalls, as you know, obviously here in Michigan and I believe two in Wisconsin. At the legislative level, you know, they sort of went for the big kahuna and they don't get it. The old saying, if you go for the king, you better get him. And so I think that it's going to have bad ramifications for the Democrats nationally. I think the Democrats recognize that. The DGA hasn't been doing much, and I don't say they pulled out, but they're not doing nearly what they could or what the RGA is doing.
How often do you talk to Snyder?
I'm not going to disclose the contents of our discussions, but I talk to him regularly.
A couple times every other week?
I communicate with him regularly. It's often by email and text and stuff, too.
Okay. How much of a concern is this bridge ballot proposal? I mean, because the way the language is written, it would seem to prevent a new bridge from being built, you know, at any time after Jan 1 of this year without public approval.
So what's the question?
How much of a concern is that? I mean, because obviously that's a huge priority for the governor.
Yeah, I honestly haven't read the ballot proposal that you're referring to. I know there is one and one exists, but I don't know a lot about it, so I can't comment much on it.
Okay.
Is the governor worried at all about the Michigan Rising recall attempt?
You know, I think he takes everything very, very seriously. The governor is a very focused person, and I don't think he wakes up in the morning thinking about RNC races or recalls or anything else. He's very focused on lowering unemployment and passing tax cuts and those sorts of things.
What do you know about him that we don't know?
Well, I think you've learned a lot about him in the last year, and we knew a lot of those things before. When you would call him naive or weak, the reality was he was very smart and very strong. And so I think the things that I knew about him that you didn't know, you've largely learned in the last year.
He doesn't love getting into the legislative process, however. This is, you know, if he could be a benevolent dictator, he'd be very happy.
Well, I'm not sure about that. I remember on your show you mentioned, I don't remember the exact words, but you said one time that John Engler understood the levers of government.
Right.
And that he had come up through the process. And,
right.
And this was before Rick won, long before, I believe.
Yep.
And so you questioned whether he'd be able to implement
sure.
his agenda at the legislative level. You know, Rick came from an outsider perspective. He brought a vision, and then he brought in the right people to help him implement that vision.
Yeah.
And so I think bringing in Brian Kelly and Dick Posthumus was very, very smart, and it's helped him implement his agenda.
Yeah, but isn't there a lot of his agenda that he hasn't implemented in terms of infrastructure, healthcare, a lot of his talent message? We haven't seen movement. In the budget cycle, he lost on a whole lot of his priorities.
I think most unbiased analysts would argue that he's accomplished a lot in a very, very short period of time.
I don't know. Bridge Magazine just had an analysis, so I don't know if you consider them to be biased.
I've never read Bridge Magazine. I'm not familiar with it.
What's the best advice your daddy ever gave you?
That's a good question. I guess just be yourself, be open, and don't succumb to pressure.
Who's leaned on you the most?
Leaning on me doesn't have a particularly solid impact. and so I tend to do what I think is right and appropriate. And so I don't succumb to pressure very easily.
So leaning doesn't work. The threats don't work.
Not particularly.
In fact, they redouble your efforts to take that person on.
Not particularly well.
Yeah. When's the last time you talked to John Engler?
You know, I probably haven't talked to John Engler since I was, 12 or 13 years old. You know,
Whoa! How old are you now? How old are you now?
He slept in my bedroom once, and so I had to go to the room downstairs when I was 10 or 12, and we went to church.
That was it? And you went to church, and then that's been it?
The reality is he and my dad were very, very close from 1989 to 1998, and so he was, I was just a young kid, not involved in politics, but he was around a lot. Whether they were traveling together, whether he was at the house or going to church or whatever, he was around as sort of part of my childhood, if you will. I wasn't involved in politics at the time. I had no idea.
Was it the Smetanka thing that broke that cord? Or was there stuff before that?
Well, certainly. I mean, it's obvious that the Smetanka thing broke the cord between my dad and Governor Engler. But I think that's less to do with why I haven't talked to him. I mean, he's been in Washington. I don't see him at events.
Yeah.
In this line of work, even if you don't necessarily get along with someone, you still see them and you're still cordial and you still say hi.
Yeah.
But it just so happens that he's not around. I also don't really go to a lot of Republican events. I have been to maybe one Lincoln dinner in 2 or 3 years. I don't go to a lot of functions.
Yeah. How old are you now?
I'm 35.
35?
Is the governor frustrated with dealing with Detroit? It seems like anytime he tries to do something there, there's so much pushback.
I haven't seen any frustration on his part. I think it's very commendable that he's putting this much focus on the city of Detroit.
Not going to get drawn into that back and forth down there. I asked him the other, I said, is there foot dragging going on in Detroit? Okay, everybody knows that there is. He said, well, that would be speculative. That was a great line.
You know, he's one of the more on-message people I've met in my life.
He is the toughest interview. He's a very tough interview.
I don't doubt that.
Yeah.
On-message is, that's not even close to say that
he's
on-message.
Do you get any credit for RPA, or was that all him? Relentless passive action.
I can't take credit for RPA. Sometimes in these campaigns, and you're sitting in a room and you're talking, it's hard to really remember exactly where things come from. But I don't remember being a part of that. No.
If it had been between he and Hoekstra, who would have won?
In a one-on-one? That's an interesting question. Hoekstra would have had a strong base. If Rick were the only, Hoekstra ended up buying many TV ads, if any, and if Rick were the only one on TV, I think Rick probably still would have won.
You think he could have outspent Hoekstra to win it?
Well, I think it's critical to go on TV to win a statewide election in the state. Yeah. I don't think you necessarily need to outspend a person, but you need to be able to get your message out.
I think the popular wisdom in town is Hoekstra would have beat him.
I've made a very good living in this business in proving the popular wisdom in town wrong, and so I don't necessarily accept that.
Okay. All right, should we go home, guys? All right, thank you guys. Appreciate it. Good show. Nice.